In this video, we've defined the inverse of a function and introduced notation for the inverse function of a one-to-one functions, and we find the inverses of these three functions. This is part 10 of functions. We're going to begin with the definition of the inverse of a function. The inverse of a function f is the set of ordered pairs formed by reversing the coordinates of each ordered pair of f. Now remember, this letter f is not a variable, it stands for the name of a function. So let's look at an example. If f equals these three ordered pairs, 5, 3, negative 1, 0, and 4, 2, state the inverse of f. So what'll that be? Well, we just take and reverse the x and y coordinates. So instead of 5, 3, we'll have 3, 5, 0, negative 1, and 2, 4. All right, let's do another one. Let's take this function. If g equals 4, 1, 3, 1, and 0, 1, then how would we find the inverse of g? Okay, so the inverse of g, what would we do? We would simply switch the x and y coordinates again. So we would have 1, 4, 1, 3, and 1, 0. Now, look at our first function, f. It's a function, and when we look at the inverse of f, we also get a function, because for each x value, there's exactly one y value. But when we look at g, it's a function, because each x value has only one y value, but the inverse is not, because we have one in more than one ordered pair, right, for x, and it's going to three different values of y. So the inverse of g is not a function. So the question is, when is the inverse of a function also a function? Well, the inverse of a function f is a function only when f is one-to-one. So the inverse of a one-to-one function f is called the inverse function of f and is written as little f with this little negative 1. Now, f is not a variable in this case. This does not mean 1 over f. So we have to be careful. That does not mean 1 over f. If f was a variable like x or n, just represented a variable, then that would be true. But in this case, we are talking about functions. All right, so let's say we have an inverse function of f. So in that case, the domain of f inverse is the range of f, and the range of f inverse is the domain of f. So in other words, they just switch the domain and the range, because you're switching all the x and y values. All right, let's suppose f is a one-to-one function where f of negative 2 equals 3 and f of 1 equals 4. So in other words, there's a lot more ordered pairs, but we do know that f of negative 2 is 3 and f of 1 is 4. Could you write the corresponding ordered pairs? Right, remember what this means? It's like f of x equals y. So that means when you put in negative 2, out comes a 3. So that's the ordered pair negative 2, 3. And the other one is 1, 4. So those are two ordered pairs in f. So what are two ordered pairs that belong to f inverse? We simply exchange the x and y coordinates. So this will give you 3, negative 2, and 4, 1. Okay, now, often you're given functions where you aren't listing all of the ordered pairs, so we have another way of finding the equation of the inverse of a one-to-one function. We're going to do that now. All right, remember function notation? We write something like f of x equals 2x minus 3. So let's say we've got a function, a one-to-one function, and it's written as an equation using this kind of function notation. Below are the steps used to find the inverse f inverse of x. 1, we're going to replace f of x with y, interchange x and y, solve for y, and then replace y with f inverse of x. Let's do an example. So I said, what if you had this function, f of x equals 3x minus 4? Now, you could find some ordered pairs on this line, but of course there's infinitely many, so you simply can't list all the ordered pairs on for this function or all the ordered pairs on the inverse. So we want to find an equation for f inverse of x. So this is f of x. So here's our steps. I'm going to call this f, and I'm going to start out by replacing f of x with y. So I'm keeping track. F is just 3x minus y equals 3x minus 4. If f is a one-to-one function, and it's written as an equation using function notation, like f of x equals 3x minus 2, below are steps used to find its inverse, which we'll call f inverse. So here are the steps. We're going to replace f of x with y. We're going to call this f. So it's going to be the function f, but we're just going to rewrite f of x using a y. Then we're going to write the function f inverse by interchanging the x and y. Next, we'll solve for y, and then we'll go back and replace y with f inverse of x. Okay, so let's do an example. So let's say we have f of x equals 3x minus 4. Our first step is to say, well, f, I'm going to write as y equals 3x minus 4. In other words, I'm replacing this f of x with a letter y. So this is still the function f written using an x and a y. All right, now we want to find f inverse. Okay, so how do we find f inverse? We want to keep track of what we're doing. We switch. Everywhere we see a y, we write an x, and everywhere we see an x, we write a y. So these are not the same functions. This is the function f, and this is the function f inverse. We want to keep track of that. Now we need to solve for y. Okay, what I'm going to do to solve for y, since it's positive over here, the 3y minus 4, I'm going to write this as 3y minus 4 equals x. Everybody hopefully agrees that's exactly the same equation. And now to solve for y, what do? We add 4 to both sides. So I have x plus 4. And then we could divide everything by 3. And notice that'll give you y equals x plus 4 over 3. So on the next step, I'm going to replace the y with f inverse of x. So I'm going to write this as f inverse of x equals x plus 4 over 3. Now, there's more than one way to write x plus 4 over 3. You could write this, it's really a line. You can write this as x over 3 plus 4 thirds, for instance. But this is fine to leave it this way. But just recall that you can write lines in different forms, like y equals mx plus b. So this is the inverse function, f inverse of x. Let's observe one more thing. We had this function, f of x equals 3x minus 4, which was a line, and we found that f inverse of x was x plus 4 over 3, which is also a line. Now, there's a couple things we can check. If we made a little table of ordered pairs for x, for instance, we know when we put in 0 for x, we get negative 4. We're plugging in 0 for x, right? And if I put in 1 for x, I get negative 1 for y, and we could try one more point for x. Let's put 2 for x. 3 times 2 minus 4 would be 6 minus 4, or 2. So these are some ordered pairs for f, and f inverse, we should get the reverse ordered pairs. Now there's infinitely many ordered pairs, correct? But we could say, well, what if I put in one of these y values for x? Like if I put in negative 4. You could verify when you put in negative 4 for x into the f inverse function, you do get 0 for y. It's the reverse ordered pair. And you know if you put in negative 1, you should get 1, and you could verify that. Putting in negative 1 for x, you're going to get 3 over 3 is 1. Lastly, if you graph it, here's something interesting. If you graph one of the functions, f of x, we've got 0, negative 4, 1, negative 1, 2, 2. And we'll just do a quick sketch of this function. This is f. To get f inverse, instead of plugging in these ordered pairs, just do the reverse ordered pairs. You could do negative 4, 0. And then we could do negative 1, 1. And we're going to have 2, 2, which just happens to be in the same place. Yeah, it's an easy way to graph F inverse as opposed to starting all over and plotting a bunch of ordered pairs. On the next video, we'll be finding the inverses of other functions besides lines.